with me here today from SUMM Therapeutics. I'm joined in the studio by Glyn Edwards. Glyn, good afternoon. Nice to see you.
Good afternoon to you too.
A big backer of yours, Bob Duggan, he's been following his cash, his investment, with a further round, $50 million. Just tell me a little bit more about what this means here for SMMT.
Well, we're a development stage company developing novel antibiotics, and this is quite an expensive part of the development process, so we need to bring more cash into the company to finish this phase three program. And our existing investors, not just Bob Duggan, but another existing investor, have put this cash in, and that really allows us to drive forward with the phase three program.
And what did he pay for the shares?
It was market price, right. 22.1 pence, so that's a 10-day moving average of the price. So a really fair deal for everybody, and allows us to concentrate on moving the product forward.
And this would have to be one of the bigger investments in your field.
Yes,
this year.
So the antibiotic field has been somewhat of an orphan in the biotech space, and so this $50 million that we're bringing out is one of the biggest investments in the field worldwide. So it's a huge ringing endorsement of the program we've got at Summit for these really narrow spectrum antibiotics that kill the bug but leave the rest of the good bacteria intact.
And so this takes his stake now to what is it, about 78%?
Yep, it does. That's correct.
Right. How influential, if you like, is he on a operational day-to-day basis?
Well, so he's going to be joining the board. He's a big shareholder, and he's going to be a board member. He's got an incredible track record. So his previous company that he sold for $21 billion was a cancer company called Pharmacyclix. And I think that was his fourth startup that he'd taken and sold on. So he's a huge life science entrepreneur. So he'll have a lot of things to contribute. But we've also got a really good team at Summit, and that's one of the things that he's investing in. So we've got great development people, great scientists, and we're starting to put in place the US marketing infrastructure that's going to be necessary to take ridinilazole to market there.
And you'll be adding the role of chairman.
Correct, yeah. So we're moving to more of a US corporate governance structure, where it's pretty common for the top person to hold the CEO and chairman role. It's very uncommon in the UK. Mm. So we're moving to more of a NASDAQ corporate governance rule.
And as such, you're looking to delist from AIM?
Yes, we're looking to delist from AIM. Nothing against AIM. AIM's done us really well. We've got some really great shareholders over here. But it's going to be a big advantage to have all our trading on NASDAQ, just one pool of liquidity in the world's biggest and deepest capital market for healthcare stocks.
Has Bob Duggan expressed any interest in increasing his stake any further?
He hasn't really looked at it from that point of view. You have to speak to himself, but from what I can see, his real interest was ensuring that the company and the project is really well funded. And so it's really great that we've got this ringing endorsement to be able to take the company forward. Because at the end of the day, we're looking at an opportunity in C. difficile infection for ridinilazole that could be sales of $1 billion in the US. You know, there are 600,000 new cases of C. difficile infection in the US every year. And with ridinilazole, we make a really significant reduction in the number of recurrences. So we have a high cure rate, low recurrences. That's really great from the patient point of view, but it offers a very big saving to the healthcare system in the US. So we should be able to share that saving between ourselves in getting a fair price and good market penetration, and the US healthcare system, which will save money from this lack of recurrences. So we see it as a massive opportunity. So the investments now are really in order to capitalize on a huge market opportunity for this novel antibiotic.
And when on the market, what would you be up against as far as other
well,
treatments?
Well, so the competition is the standard of care at the moment, which is a drug called vancomycin, which has done us really well over the last decades. But it's a broad spectrum agent. And so what that means is they have good cure rates, but because it also obliterates large parts of the microbiome, so these are the good bacteria in the gut, it leaves patients susceptible to having a recurrence. So currently, more than a quarter and up to a third of patients will be cured by vancomycin, but then have a recurrence of the disease. And that's really bad for the patient, but it's also really expensive because they come back into hospital, they have to be retreated. And that's where we think ridinilazole can have a big advantage. We think we can be just as good, if not better, at the initial cure, but offer a really material reduction in the recurrences. And we showed that in phase two. We showed statistically significant reductions in the sustained cure. So it looks really, really promising.
So you're busy recruiting now for that trial?
Yeah, there's two sorts of recruitment. We're recruiting marketing people to set up our sales and marketing organization. But the big recruitment, if you come into Summit and talk about recruitment, what we mean is recruiting patients into the study. Mm. Now, these patients are global studies. They're really hard in infectious diseases. So the first part of the study is getting the sites and the hospitals all trained up to do it, and we're just coming to the end of that. We're almost at our target number of hospitals now, and so then the focus comes on to getting the patients into the study, and that's going really well at the moment.
And you'd be expecting a readout from this trial?
Yes, so we expect to spend all of 2021 recruiting patients, and then as we get into early 21, we should finish the recruitment, and about 6 months later, we should have the data. So first half of 2021 for finishing recruitment, second half for the data, and then getting to the FDA and the EMA as quick as we can after that, because this looks like being a treatment that's going to become the new standard of care for C. difficile infection.
And is it at that point you'd look to partner to get to market?
Well, so in the US, we're going to market ourselves. But in the rest of the world, we're in active discussions over partnering, looking at Europe, looking at China and the Far East. We've already got a partnership in Latin America with Europharma, which is going really well, not just preparing for commercialization, but also in recruiting patients out there. Interestingly, in the past, the number two market for pharmaceuticals after the US was always Europe. But actually, as we project forward here, the number two market for ridinilazole could very well be China. So actually, a lot of our effort is on looking to find partners in China.
Well, clearly a busy year for ridinilazole. What about the remainder of the portfolio?
Yeah, we think this is an opportunity in many other bacterial infections. Again, in the past, it was all about getting a single drug that could do everything. Now we know that the microbiome is really important. So we're looking to develop brand new mechanism of action drugs that will hit new targets. That's really important to get around the growing resistance that we see. But also really important for patient health is to kill the infection, stop the infection in its tracks, but leave all the other organisms that contribute to good health in place. So we have a program in gonorrhea that's looks really exciting and promising, and a program in a group of bacteria called Enterobacteriaceae, and those are things like E. coli, which cause all sorts of nasty urinary tract infections and bloodstream infections and pneumonia. So it's looking really promising for a whole family of antibiotics, which are precision, take out the bug that we want to, leave the other organisms intact, and leave a healthier human being at the end of the day.
Well, Glyn, a final word from you then. We're almost at the end of 2019. As we look ahead to the next year, what are you most proud about? How would you sum up where Summit Therapeutics
Summit's
is at the moment?
Summit's made huge steps forward this year. So as you mentioned, this is one of the biggest investments in an antibiotic company worldwide. This year, we've started our phase three program, got lots of sites up and running, and starting to see recruitment into the trial picking up. And we're starting to build an embryonic sales and marketing organization in the US with our first few hires there. So next year is going to be about completing the bulk of recruitment into the study, carrying on building the sales and marketing infrastructure, and bringing along these other products. So I think 2020 is going to be very, very exciting for us.
Good to see you. Thanks very much.
Thank you.